to the life you hold.
Things I had some for. Feel like I'm Peter reaching out in a storm. Yeah, it's crazy. Every time you call me, but I never saw it. Every time you tell me, just go back where you call me. How we even started, now I'm just a far away. Too worried about my problems, I ain't let God in. Yeah, it's a game changing when I speak to the Son of Man who got me in his hands. I don't need to pretend like I got it all together, cause he do. He will never leave you. Every day we need you.
Before I had God in my life, thought I knew what freedom was like. Before you came open my eyes, new life, wide-eyed in your new life. I'm gonna sing about it, dance about it. New life, wide-eyed in your new life. I'm gonna sing about it.
Good morning, everyone.
Hello, hello, hello. Morning. Welcome to
church. So great to see you all here today. My name is Bree, and I work with creatives here, as well as programming, as well as some of our youth. And yeah. Who are you?
I'm Jace. I'm one of our youth leaders here at Gracegate. Work through Oasis and our fuel department.
That's right. If it is your first time here today, we want to give you an extra special welcome. We have a few things we'd like to say here at Gracegate, right, Jace?
We do. The first one is no perfect people allowed.
That's right, no perfect people. You don't have to believe to belong, and we're just so grateful that you've chosen to come and spend your Saturday morning here with us. We are a church that is, yeah, with you and for you, so we're excited to get going today. All right, well, Jason and I have had a pretty good start to the week, hey?
We have. We have been away on surf camp. We have been up in the Kaipara Harbour at our farm.
Yep.
And surfing every day at Waipu Cove.
Yep. Although we haven't personally been surfing, sadly. We've actually been facilitating a surf camp for all of the teenagers here at Gracegate and in the community. So we've been helping to teach them to surf. We've been running different activities. What else have we been doing up at camp, Jace?
So we've been jet skiing, we've been scuba skidding, we had a raft building day.
We did. We bonfires.
Daily devotions. It was an epic camp.
It was epic. And we thought, rather than us just tell you more and more about it, let's actually get some of our young people up on stage to join us and share. So can I invite Logan and Paige to join us? Yes! Come on up! So these guys both joined us on surf camp. We've had the whole week with them, and we're not even sick of them yet. All right, so can you guys introduce yourselves, maybe tell us your name, your age, and how you're involved here at Gracegate?
I'm Paige, I'm 15, and I help dance and teach at Tuesday Dance, obviously. And I'm also involved with Fuel.
I'm Logan, I'm 14, and I'm on holidays from Australia.
That's okay. Right. We even accept Australians here at Grace Day. All right.
No perfect people allowed.
So, can you guys share with us, what was your favourite thing about surf camp this week, Paige?
I really enjoyed meeting new people and just having laughs with everybody.
Nice. What about you, Logan? What was your favourite part?
Surfing while making new friends at the beach.
Nice.
Awesome.
And
awesome.
These guys both got some awesome waves, actually.
They did.
Everyone did. Cool.
All right, we're moving on to our next question. So every day we do like a daily devotion up at camp. Can you tell me what was the one that stood out for you the most?
We learnt what an airworm is, which is a song or a thought that keeps replaying on your head over and over, and how you can replace the bad airworms with good ones.
I love that. Well said.
I really enjoyed learning about how to increase the sounds of your positive thoughts to flush out all of your negative ones.
That's right. So our kind of theme for the week that we chatted about with these guys was about creating a new playlist and kind of using the metaphor of our like Spotify playlist for the thoughts and the feelings, I guess, that can get stuck in our heads. So it was really helpful, hey? All right.
It was.
All right, last question. If, and I see there are other teenagers sitting out here today, what would you say to them to maybe encourage them to join Fuel or come on a camp in the future?
Surf camps and Fuel camps are just so much fun. You get to meet so many new people and just get to know everyone really closely.
Cool. Nice. What about you, Logan?
Coming to Fuel camps and surf camps is really fun because you can learn about God and meet new friends on the way.
Awesome. Guys, can we give Logan and Paige a big round of applause? Thank you, guys. All right. And before we stop talking about surf camp, Jason, do you have a favourite thing that happened at surf camp?
There was so much to choose from. The weather for a start. But I have to say, my favourite part was learning that you can make a Formula One car sound with an empty Coke can.
That was not my favourite part.
No, it was favourite for about 30 seconds. 45 minutes later in the drive, it got a little bit rough. But
yeah.
It was enlightening.
No, it was great. And that's something we love doing here at Gracegate, is investing in our youth and our young people and just, yeah, having that relationship. It was an awesome week. And we actually have something really cool to show you, a little video soon. But before we get there, we wanted to chat to you guys, because if you're thinking, man, that sounds so cool, I wish I could go camp at the farm, play on the jet skis, build rafts, sit around a bonfire, well, you can, because this next coming weekend, we have our church family camp. So, Jace, what is our info for family camp?
So, it's this weekend. It's all up here, 27th to the 29th of January. It's at the farm in Mangatarotu. You can register by scanning that QR code. If you're struggling with it, don't ask me, because I'm not very technology orientated. But come along. It's going to be an awesome camp. There's going to be a whole heap of people there, and it's about community at the end of the day, right?
That's right. And if you can't make it for the whole weekend, then you can just come up for the day on the Sunday and just hang out for the whole day. Do a little day trip up there with your friends or your family. So make it a priority and come along and join us for that. And then our last announcement today.
This one's important. So this Tuesday, we have our life group starting back up.
Right.
Come along, get involved every Tuesday evening.
Yeah.
I think if you go to Robin and Shay would be the people to ask about it, but yeah, it's a great thing to be involved in, to talk more about God and to ask some questions.
Yeah, that's right. And no matter what your age or your stage of life or your experience in church, it doesn't matter. It is a safe place to come, and there's a place for you somewhere, so we can help you find that. And then, yeah, before we head off the stage, like we promised, we have a video. So we actually had Rethi, our videographer, come up for a day and film. So we have some awesome footage just to make you really, really jealous of all the great things that we did with the teens this past week at our Fuel Surf Camp. So take a look at the screen and enjoy.
That looks amazing. Good morning. Welcome to church. This is the time where we stand and sing, so I'll invite you all to stand this morning, and let's sing. Light up the way of your heart, move me like you do the mountains, move me like you do the wind, and I'll chase your voice through the dark, fix my eyes on the unexpected, in the wonder of your shadow steer, so take another step. Sinner's table, I found you waiting by the well, unexpected. You were always there, chasing all my steps. Move me like you to the mountains, move me like you to the wind, and I'll chase your voice through the dark, fix my eyes on the unexpected, in the wonder of your shadow stare, so take another step.
Trace at all you are. But when I think about the road you took along, I know your grace will stay the path. I love the way of your heart. Move me like you do the mountains. Move me like you do the
song we're going to sing is called Waymaker, and we have a very special treat. So in music group this last week, I said to the guys, you know, we're all vibing on the song, so I said, well, why don't you guys come and join us on Saturday, sing Waymaker. And so yeah, let's do this. Go ahead, Jeff. Everybody sing.
You are here, moving in our midst. I worship you. I worship
you. You are here.
You are here, working in this place.
I worship.
I worship you.
Oh,
I worship you.
You are way maker.
Waymaker, a miracle worker, promise keeper.
working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working.
You never
stop, you never stop.
For us. And the reason why they touch me, and I hope they touch you, is that I don't know what it was like for you guys growing up, you know, with authority figures. You know, there's that authority figure. I'm sure there's someone in your life, because I know there's someone in mine, and they let you down. You know, you feel like they're against you. You know, they give you a hard time when you didn't deserve it. And sometimes you just feel like the world's against you. And I think the unfortunate thing is that sometimes the world, they portray God as this being or this thing that is against you, that doesn't care about you, who's always looking down at you every time you make a mistake and says, how dare you? Who do you think you are? That's not God. That's not Him. Because when you make a mistake, He's like, come on, get back up. I love you. It's okay. It's okay. My mercy is sufficient for you. And these just aren't my words. I'll read from the Bible. In Isaiah, he says, don't be afraid, for I am with you. Don't be discouraged, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will hold you up with my victorious right hand. He also says, in His word it says, if God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold His own Son, but gave Him up for all of us, will He not with Him also give up everything else? I pray that these words that we sing next will touch your heart, and believe it, God loves you. And He is with you, and He is for you. Please sing with us.
shine upon. Be gracious to the Lord, turn his face toward you and be.
Going through our series called Summer Vibes, and if you haven't been with us over the past couple weeks, we've been looking at a few themes that hopefully will benefit us as we have kicked off 2024. The first week we kind of spoke a bit about the Sabbath, and we looked at how valuable it is to actually take a day of rest and not work, and it's kind of, we saw that we've actually been created to have that kind of rhythm. It's so beneficial for us. And last week we spoke a bit about having a healthy body. We saw the value of that and how having a healthy physical body actually impacts pretty much all areas of our lives. And we encouraged, and I encourage you, to just take one step in the direction of maybe healthier eating, healthier sleeping, and maybe even healthier exercise, or doing some exercise or moving. Who did that? Anyone did one step maybe this week? Yeah? That is awesome. Can we give everyone a hand who did that? All right. And we're encouraging just one small step in the right direction. And basically where we found this was from this passage in Romans, Paul sharing this with the church. He said, "And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because of all he has done for you." And then it went on, and it said, "Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him." And so we saw that we can actually worship God through our physical bodies and the way we actually look after them and care for them, because it impacts every aspect of our life. But that's where we looked at last week, and I want to continue with this verse, because the very next verse says this. It says, "Don't copy the behavior and customs of this world, but let God," check this out, "transform you into a new person by changing the way you" what? Think. All right? "Let God transform you into a new person by changing the way you think." If you're wanting to allow God to transform you, Paul's encouraging us here to change the way we think. And then he says this. He says, "Then you will learn to know God's will for you, which is good and pleasing and perfect." And I don't know about you, but I often just want to know God's will. Like, what's God's will for my life? Which direction should I go into? What's the best move? What's the wise thing to do? Paul's encouraging us here that God will guide us and help us with that as we change the way we think. And that's why today, I want to take some time and speak about a healthy mind. A healthy mind. Let's maybe bow our heads and we'll just say a prayer. God, this morning's been a bit different, worshiping you and then hearing even the fire alarms get involved and cause some rhythm. But most importantly today, God, we're young because we want to learn, we want to grow. And sometimes even as I communicate, I think, what's the point? What's the point of sharing some of this stuff, God? And I know it's often because of the lies and the false beliefs, because the incredible power that the Holy Spirit can use someone imperfect like me to voice something that is so valuable and truthful in someone's life today can have ripple effects in so many ways. And so we just trust your Holy Spirit to take over now, to speak to us, to help us with our thinking. That's our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. Does anyone know what this is? What? Kidney bean. Yeah, it does definitely look like that. But if you see the size of it, that's 1 millimeter. So it is pretty much about, what, maybe 3 millimeters? Which would be about how big? About that big? All right. That's a centimeter, roughly. That would be, yeah. Anyone seen something like this? It's a what? It's a seed, yeah. It's a seed. I'm not really a plant expert, but I know this is a seed. And it comes from this plant. It's called kudzu. Okay? Anyone ever heard of that plant? Kudzu? No? Not making this up. Can you say that word? Kudzu? Right? You're going to learn something new today. Kudzu is this incredible plant, and check how beautiful it looks. All right? That is it. Apparently, this incredible plant actually also smells like sweet grape. All right? That's quite a cool plant. Now, it originates from Japan. It's also found in China. Korea, and Japan actually gifted this plant to North America. As history tells, it was, I think, as a celebration of their independence, not exactly sure when. And so this was the gift that they gave them, which, you know, looks really beautiful. What an awesome thing to have. The only problem with this plant is this is what happened with the plant. All right, and North America. It's actually defined, it's got a nickname as the plant that ate the South. So if you go to the south of the USA, this is kudzu all over. Now, they say don't sleep with your windows open because kudzu will come in. And surprisingly, it grows at 30 centimeters per 24 hours. All right? 30 centimeters per 24 hours. So you can see why this is a huge pest, especially in the USA and various other countries. I even saw that there is kudzu in New Zealand up north. And surprisingly, though, in Japan, it's not a problem because they actually have this little bug. It's called the kudzu bug that actually eats it and maintains its growth. So it's not a huge problem there. But as you can see, it's pretty destructive over here. Apparently, I don't know if this is very accurate. It's just a Google search. But apparently, it costs $500 million. That's the economic impact that the USA have to pay to maintain it, all right? So quite a big thing from a tiny little small seed. What's also fascinating about this plant is its root system. There you can see one of its roots. They grow about, I think, 18 centimeters in diameter, and they can grow upwards of 3 meters deep, all right? So you can imagine it is quite a problem. In Asia, though, it's they use it to eat and so many other things, but it's a huge pest in most other places, all right? Very interesting. Small little seed can make such a huge impact. And pretty much it covers houses, it covers electric poles, light poles in the USA, and it is honestly just a really difficult plant to control. This morning I want to ask you this question, and that is, what seeds have taken root in your mind? What seeds have been planted in your mind, and how are they growing? Is it a seed that is bearing an incredible plant with great fruit? Or is it similar to this kudzu plant that has taken root in your mind and it has just gone totally out of control? Grown totally out of control, impacting every aspect of your life. What seeds have taken root in your mind? And I know that for most of us, we've got so many seeds that have been planted in our minds that are actually not helpful for us. That those false beliefs, that those lies, that those past experiences that we've been through, they are those relationships that we've had with either our parents. Maybe it's been a romantic relationship, maybe it's been as a child, and all these little events or situations or relationships have impacted our thinking. What seeds have you got rooted in your mind? And as much as you try to let go of that, you just see that it keeps recurring over and over again, and it impacts the way you live, the way you act, the things you do or the things that you don't do, these false beliefs. I know that a lot of us have so many, and the crazy part about it, as I shared last week, is if you're a Christian, and even if you aren't, we believe that there's actually an enemy who's loves these. He loves these false beliefs. He loves these lies that we hang on to and that impact every aspect of our life. This passage in the Word says this: be alert and of sober mind. He says, your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour. Like there's an enemy. And I love this picture of a lion, because if you've ever seen a lion hungry or a lioness who needs to feed her cubs, like they are so strategic, so deceptive, so cunning in making sure they can get their prey. And once they get their prey and they have a big feed, guess what? It's not over. A couple days later, they're on the road again, looking again who they can attack. And this is the language that we see in this passage, that, hey, there's an enemy. There's an enemy who wants to actually destroy us. Now, I thought of this, and there's really, honestly, a list that could probably be, you know, I don't know, 100+ thousand sayings, lies, false beliefs that we say to each other. Yes, some of them. I thought I'll put them up. Maybe some of us say this: I must please other people to be loved or accepted. And it's interesting, because often we don't say these things. These are just things in our mind. These are just our thoughts. These are just our unhealthy thinking patterns. Maybe it's this. We say, my emotions always represent truth. Like, we don't really communicate this, but we feel it. We think it. Some others, I'm unworthy of love or acceptance. And the way this is kind of, this is in our thinking, but it's lived out, because it's lived out in the way we do or we don't do things, right? Some others are, I must be right to be significant or to know I am of value. I must perform, achieve, to be accepted. Others say, my past determines who I am. I must figure out my future to be secure. I can't handle this. Whatever circumstances are going on, we're just like, I can't handle this. I'm responsible for the happiness of other people, and they are responsible for mine. I am who I am. I shouldn't have to change this. It's just the way I am. I've been like this for 20 years. Things aren't going to change. This is just, the false belief I believe. Or the last one I put up is, real men do not show they need help. False beliefs, often we're probably not communicating this with anyone, but it's just in our mind. It's just in our thinking pattern. It's just, hey, that unhealthy thoughts that actually impact the way we live our life. So what do we do with this? What do we do with this? Because just like that small little seed of kudzu, if we don't do something, it is so destructive. And for a lot of us, we know how destructive it is. It keeps us running in the wrong direction to try and recover and try and heal and try and break through, but we actually never actually get the breakthrough that we need. And I believe that this is a very spiritual thing, that this isn't something we can just attend or do. It's not a program we can just tick off and say, hey, we're going to be cured, because these thinking patterns just keep recurring all the time, and the enemy loves just highlighting them, helping them to stand out in our life. So the Bible actually encourages us so many times about our mindset, about how we think. And I think that's the reason why Paul, right in the beginning, where he said, hey, the way you're going to be transformed by God is through your thinking. Is through your thinking. So he has some ideas and some passages that will help us in actually combating some of these false beliefs. The first one is this, found in 2 Corinthians. It says, we demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, and we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. I love this. We demolish arguments, because I think in our headspace, that's where we're having a lot of the arguments. We're not sleeping, we're not talking to people, we're not doing things, because we're just arguing with ourselves about untruths, about things that aren't even true, and it's taken us hostage. But Paul encourages us, if we go back, and he says, hey, to actually take every thought captive. And I like that, because have you ever pictured like being captive, like how that looks? I watched a documentary series once on Netflix. Don't watch it if you don't like to see craziness, but it's a documentary of people who actually take people from around the world hostage, and some of them never make it out. But think of that. Maybe you've watched a movie of being captive or being a hostage, right? Paul's using strong language here, and he's saying, we take every thought captive. Every thought captive. In other words, we put it on a chair, we tie it up, we put handcuffs on it, we stand there with an AK-47, and we actually assess that thought, if it is true or if it is a lie. And we do that by looking at the truth, taking every thought captive to make it obedient to Christ. In other words, we compare it with what God says. We compare it with what the Bible echoes to us. Because half of the time we're living from a place of lies and deception. Another verse that helps us with this is in Romans. It says, those who are dominated by the sinful nature think about sinful things, but those who are controlled, check this out, by the Holy Spirit, think about things that please the Spirit. And this is why I say this is so spiritual. And this is that space where instead of us just controlling and trying to control our whole lives, this is a space where we invite the Holy Spirit and say, God, we really want to surrender our thinking patterns and we want you to help us with our thoughts. Then he says this will happen. He says, so letting your sinful nature control your mind, it leads to death. He says, hey, if you're going to control your thoughts and you're not going to get any help or support, guess what? It's going to lead you down a destructive path. But then he says, but letting the Spirit control your mind leads to life. And one of the most important words that we all crave, peace. Peace. How many of our thoughts are wrecking our peace? How many of our false beliefs, lies, thinking is stealing our life and peace? Paul's encouraging us here, saying, hey, if we are governed, if we are controlled by the Holy Spirit in our thinking, we're going to experience life, and our mind is going to lead to life and peace. And I know that if there was a pill for peace, most of us would take that pill every single day, right? Another passage, Paul encouraging the church in Philippi, he says this, finally, brothers and sisters, hey, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Think about such things. What are you thinking about? What is your daily thoughts consist of? Paul says, yeah, hey, I want you to pursue what is true, what is trustworthy. He says, I want you to pursue what is right, what is pure, what is lovely. Because this impacts our life. And he goes on. He says, whatever you have learned or received or heard from who? From me or seen in me, put it into practice and the God of what? Peace will be with you. And I love this because Paul's, you know, helping us see that we actually have to be intentional about our thinking. Just like the enemy is intentional about pursuing us and trying to highlight those false beliefs and lies, he's saying we actually need to be intentional to actually find what is true, what is right, what is trustworthy. It's not something we can just sit back and not be intentional about. We need to take those thoughts captive and see, hey, can I trust this? Is this something that is truthful? And then the way we do this, which I love, and I want to encourage as we're in to 2024, is we get in the Word. We get in the Word. This is what the author of Hebrews says. He says, for the Word of God is alive and active, sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. And I love this. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. It judges. Now, we actually, a lot of us don't like judges, yeah? All right? But it always depends on the outcome, right? And yeah, it says that, hey, the Word of God, it actually judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. In other words, it helps clarify and show us, hey, what can be trusted? What is truthful? What do I need to lean on? What do I need to actually plant in my head that seed and allow it to grow versus, hey, what do I need to uproot and take out and destroy and replace? The Word of God does that. One of the things that I think we can do to help with our thinking is to really just get in the Word. And when I say in the Word, I just mean just read some passages of the Bible. What it does is it judges our thoughts. It helps us to see that, hey, your thinking is distorted. Your thinking is not accurate. Let me show you what the truth of the Word of God actually says. And what it does is, if we look at some of those lies that we looked at earlier, for instance, times when we see, hey, I must please other people to be loved or accepted. If we look at that and we take it captive and we actually look at it in the context of the Word of God and what can be trusted, then we'll actually see that, hey, I am to please God rather than seek the approval of people. And if we take all of these lies, look at this. My emotions always represent truth. If we take it and we actually look at that, compare that in the Word of God, we'll see this, that emotions can and will deceive me. And we start, the more we actually get in the Word, start to read it, and start feeding and watering our thoughts and our thinking, the more truth we're going to be living from. I am unworthy of love or acceptance. We'll see that nothing can separate me from the love of God in Christ. Nothing. If we look at another false belief, and we say, hey, I must be right to be significant or to know I am of value. Guess what? You don't have to be right all the time. You can relax. My value and significance come from a humble dependence on God. Maybe another false belief is I must perform or achieve to be accepted. Guess what? God accepts me, not because of anything I have done. It's about everything He has done and just how He loves us, how He cares for us, how He sees us. He values us, full stop. If we have this false belief of my past determines who I am, well, guess what? My past is not who I am, because I am a new creation in Christ. Completely new creation. I'm not defined by what I have done or haven't done. I must figure out my future to be secure. I love this. We can relax. Our future is secured by God. We can trust that. It's truth. Maybe it's, I can't handle this, whatever we're going through. The Word helps us and educates us and says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens us. And maybe it's, I'm responsible for the happiness of other people and they are responsible for mine. No. Guess what the truth says? It says, I am not responsible for the happiness of other people. Actually, God is. God is. I can support, I can help, but that's not my responsibility. God's in control. And maybe I am who I am. I shouldn't have to change. That's a false belief. Because the truth, if we look in the Word, it actually says God's plan for me is to actually mature and to grow. It's to uproot some of those false beliefs. It's to take out. And maybe this one for all us guys, real men do not show that they need help. No, it's a false belief. Pride is followed by destruction, right? It's amazing how we want to hold on to these false beliefs. Thinking that if we think this way and we act and we live from this place, it will get us to a better place. But it never does. Keeps us stranded, keeps us in a faulty thinking pattern. If we go on to the next question, I want to bring this back to the question I asked earlier. What seeds have taken root in your mind? What seeds? Because at the end of the day, yes, there's many seeds that will just get thrown at us and get planted there. But we have the responsibility to actually take them out and to actually say, hey, I don't need this seed there. God's also encouraging us that He's going to help us, His Holy Spirit guiding us. He will help us to define what is a good seed, not a helpful seed to have. What is lies, what is truth? As we get in His Word, as we walk to become more fully devoted followers of Jesus, that's what He does. That's who He is. And that's what impacts our life in so many ways. What's your thoughts? What's your thinking? Where are they leading you to? My encouragement for us today is to do this. Number one is to go away from here today. Even if you just take a few minutes, I can guarantee this is going to help you, all right? And just write it out. Maybe you have to write out that false belief that you're hanging on to, and then you've got to write next to it the truth. Maybe it's one of those things I mentioned, but there's a whole list of others that you could have. Maybe it's just one of those things. Go home and just write it out. Write it on your phone, that false belief, and then write the truth. In other words, write that out and then just say, well, what does God think about this? Is this true? Is this helpful? Is this kind? And then write that truth out. And then I just want you to think about it. Think about it. Keep thinking about it over and over again. Keep memorizing about the truth, who God says you are, what He says about this situation. Because the more that we do that, the more that plant is going to flourish in our minds, and it's going to come out in the way we live our life. And then lastly, I want us to speak it. Because the reality is, so many of us are speaking lies, and a lot of us are listening to it and just agreeing, saying that's true. But it's not. And so if we could actually speak it out, and hopefully church is about community, helping us grow, helping us mature, helping us get better in our faith journey. If we can hear untruths, we can call it out, right? We can say, hey, that's not true. That might have been the case in your past, but that is not true for who you are today and who God says you are. You need to actually start speaking the truth. So can we do that? Just as one step this week, can we just take a few minutes to write down one false belief? Each and every one of us, I can guarantee you, have that in this room. Might be in the context of your family, might be in the context of your addiction, might be in the context of your work life, whatever it is, might be in the context of your faith journey. Write down that false belief and just compare it with the truth. And let's see what happens. Let's see how we can get rid of some of that kudzu plant and allow God to actually grow healthy thinking in our minds this year. So God, today, those destructive thoughts, those negative thoughts, they don't leave us. They just keep coming back. And that's why it's so important for us to get into a relationship with you where your Holy Spirit continues to help us on a daily basis, judging, defining, giving us wisdom, clarity, and at the end of the day, helping us uproot those unhealthy seeds, God. So many of us could be living from a place that is not helpful to us, God. And it's just controlling every aspect of our life. And we crave peace. We crave peace. We crave life. We want to experience the benefits that this life has to offer and that you have to offer for us, God. And so it is our humble prayer today, God. Please renew our thinking. When we have so many distorted and deceptive lies that we believe that the enemy breeds, may we just get rid of those, God, and just hang on to your truths on a daily basis. I pray that this community can continue to speak truth to each other, that we just get better and stronger with the quality of our lives because we are trusting in the Word of God. That's our prayer today. In the powerful name of Jesus, amen.
Let's all stand. Let's think about the renewing of our mind as we sing the song, I Speak Jesus.
Thank you.
Like to pray over something, one of those thoughts that has taken root in your mind, or maybe you've got something else going on, but if you'd love to have someone pray with you and for you today, then you can just head through these doors to the side and we'll have a team there to pray for you. If you've got any other questions or you'd like to figure out how to get involved, then our next steps desk is the best place to go. Go and see Blair, he's really nice and friendly, and he will help you out. He'll get you connected, answer any questions that you have, or point you to the right person. We just want to remind you, before you finish today, to make sure that you do connect with us at our family camp next weekend. Make sure you get signed up. Come join us for the day. Bring a friend. It's going to be awesome. And also that life groups kick off this week. So many ways for you to connect. We hope to see your faces everywhere. And yeah, feel free to stay for coffee, iced coffee as well, after church today. Thanks, guys.